Let's just go ahead and pray. Father in heaven, we come to you on this wonderful morning that you've given us, the rain that you've given to water the land is just fantastic. And we just pause to thank you again and to acknowledge you as the sovereign of the universe and the sovereign of our redemption and restoration. Thank you very much for all the blessings you give us for your Son, and we just ask that you will be with us here today, and as some folk are leaving, that you will send angels that excel in strength to protect them till they get to their journey's end, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's kind of funny how God works, certainly from my experience. It wasn't only a couple of days ago that I woke up with a thought, and I gingerly started exploring that thought, and then I think even when I presented it, I said, I'm about to step out on some thin ice. And it wasn't long after that that Craig introduced another verse to my mind that said exactly what I thought. And this morning, last night in fact, when I was looking at what would happen this morning, I found an old document, and I've been looking for a verse for some time, so I'd just like you to turn to Isaiah 44, chapter 22. And the topic that I've been talking about is the fact that redemption occurred prior to the foundations of the world being laid. So we've been redeemed by God before the plan of salvation was put into place. But that redemption was manifested at the cross. And Isaiah 44:2. Could somebody with a loud voice read that for me? 44:22. I won't forget that.
I have blotted out as a thick cloud thy transgressions, and as a cloud thy sins be turned unto me, for I have redeemed.
What did he say? Return unto me, why? So what comes first?
Redemption.
Isn't that another verse just to reinforce that we're not crazy when we think these things? That God has redeemed us. And he says, because I've redeemed you, and I've blotted out your sins, please return to me. We kind of think, well, I'll ask a question. How many of you have ever heard someone say to you, if you do not confess your sins, God is unable to forgive you? Oh, I grew up with it. Unbelievable. So this morning we're actually going to have a look at forgiveness, the restoration part of the everlasting gospel. So I'd like to start Matthew 9 and verse 2. Can somebody read that to us?
And behold, they brought to him a man sick of a palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven.
Thy sins be forgiven thee. I'm just going to increase the size of this font so I can see it. Okay, this was the palsied man, the one that was lowered down through the roof of Peter's house. Interestingly enough, I wanted to read this to you. I can't improve upon it, so I'm just going to read what Ellen White said. The palsied man was entirely helpless, and seeing no prospect of aid from any quarter, he had sunk into despair. Then he had heard of the wonderful works of Jesus. He was told that others as sinful and as helpless as he had been healed. Now, what would you think, Craig, if I come over to you and say, hey, come to Jesus, there's guys that are as sinful as you. How would you react? I'm not alone.
Speak for yourself.
That's the thought that I had. Speak for yourself. Even lepers have been cleansed. And the friends who reported these things encouraged him to believe that he too might be cured if he could be carried to Jesus. But this hope fell when he remembered how the disease had been brought upon him. He feared that the pure physician would not tolerate him in his presence. Yet it was not physical restoration he desired so much as the relief of the burden of sin. If he could see Jesus and receive the assurance of forgiveness and peace with heaven, he would be content to live or die according to God's will. The cry of the dying man was, "Oh, that I might come into his presence." There was no time to lose. Already his flesh wasted, showing signs of decay. He besought his friends to carry him on his bed to Jesus, and this they gladly undertook to do. But so dense was the crowd that had assembled in and about the house where the Saviour was, that it was impossible for the sick man and his friends to reach him, or even to come within hearing of his voice. Jesus was teaching in the house of Peter. According to their custom, he sat close, his disciples sat close to him. I'll just drop down a little bit. Again and again, the bearers of the paralytic tried to push their way through the crowd, but in vain. The sick man looked about him in unutterable anguish. When the longed for help was so near, how could he relinquish hope? At his suggestion, his friends bore him to the top of the house and breaking up the roof. Wouldn't you like it if somebody started breaking up the roof of your house? And breaking up the roof, let him down at the feet of Jesus. The discourse was interrupted. The Saviour looked upon the mournful countenance and saw the pleading eyes fixed upon him. He understood the case. He had drawn him to himself, that perplexed and doubting spirit. While the paralytic was yet at home, the Saviour had brought conviction to his conscience. When he repented of his sins and believed in the power of Jesus to make him whole, the life-giving mercies of the Saviour had first blessed his longing heart. Jesus had watched the first glimmer of faith grow into a belief that he was the sinner's only help, and he had seen it grow stronger with every effort to come into his presence. Now, in the words that fell like music on the sufferer's ear, the Saviour said, "Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven." That's all he wanted to hear, wasn't it? "Thy sins be forgiven." Does that ring out in your heart? So we want to have a look at this idea of forgiveness. Notice that the first thing Jesus said was, "Thy sins be forgiven." He didn't say to him, "Have you repented?"
I've already repented.
He had.
Yeah.
But didn't they believe that sicknesses came because of sin in those days?
In another place in Ellen White, she said that his palsy was as a direct result of the life that he had lived. So yes. But if you continue into that, the Pharisees, he'd gone to the Pharisees for help, and the Pharisees had declared him beyond help because his sins couldn't be forgiven. And the Pharisees were sitting there watching this, and because when they saw it, they decided that something's got to be done, this guy's got to die, and they said, because he said, "Thy sins be forgiven me," that was a blasphemy worthy of death. So from that point on, they started to plot his death. All because he, and a little bit later on, when Jesus explains it, he said, "Well, what's easier to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or rise, take up thy bed and walk?" Just so that you know that the Son of Man has been given authority to forgive sins on earth. And then he said, "Rise, take up thy bed and walk." Yes, Beth?
Well, it just occurred to me that repenting didn't heal him.
No.
Yeah, so that's a different thing. Repentance doesn't heal.
Whoops. Repenting is a condition of the heart, though,
yes,
isn't it?
That's right. But that some people seem to think that will heal you of what's the consequence. but it didn't do it.
You know, as I was coming back to thinking on spiritual things and wanting to know the truth and wanting to know if God existed and all of these thoughts that were going through my mind, there were questions that, well, what if I haven't repented properly? What if I haven't confessed hard enough? And you see this brought out with self-flagellation, where they whack themselves on the back because they don't know that they've confessed hard enough. And then reading through General Conference Bulletin 1901, page 36, that let us remember this, that when Christ had taken the necessary steps of repentance, conversion and faith in behalf of humanity, he went down to the Jordan to be baptized of John. That just meant so much. We don't have to think those thoughts, because the standard of perfection that God requires, Christ has delivered as you. He had no need of repentance, did he? No need of conversion? He did, because we were all in him. But in his individual character, he had no need. But as us, he's done it. So you don't have to think like I used to think, what if I haven't repented hard enough? Doesn't matter. Whatever you've done, God knows your heart. And if you're repenting, he knows that your heart is in the right place. The words may not be perfect, doesn't have to be. Christ has already done that for you. When we look at forgiveness, there's another story. Remember the story in Simon's house where Mary came and started putting the alabaster ointment on his feet, and there was murmurings, and Jesus rebuked the murmurings and said, this woman has been forgiven much. He repeated it again. He said to her, your sins are forgiven. It gave her hope, has it not? When Jesus was going into the desert, what did God give him to be able to fight the battle with Lucifer or with Satan? You are my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. When he was in the garden, tasting eternal non-existence, sweating drops of blood, and the angel came not to take the cup, what did he give Christ? The assurance of his Father's love. Isn't that what all humanity yearn? The knowledge that somebody loves them? And with that knowledge, that one piece of information, whilst Christ, that the cup wasn't taken from Christ, the depression left him and he was strengthened to meet the ordeal. With that one piece of information, he went through all that torture. If you can hang on to the fact that you are loved, you will overcome. You will, because that's the promise of God. But I wanted to look at a bit more at the parable of the unforgiving debtor. So let's turn to Matthew 18. I made some notes last night, but I forgot to tear out of Kathy's notebook. So I've just got them. So Matthew 18, starting at verse 21. And let's just read that down to verse 27. Craig, would you start, please?
Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Till seven times?
Jesus said unto them, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven.
Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants.
And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents.
But forasmuch as he had not to pay, his lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children, and all that he had, in payment to be made.
The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all.
And the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him, and forgave him the debt.
Yeah, but just there, up to there is fine. Thanks, Leah. Interestingly enough, when we look at this, it's a parable, is it not?
Mm.
And it's a physical story designed to give us a spiritual understanding. Remember, the physical comes first, the spiritual second, according to Paul. Okay, so in this verse, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a certain king. Who do you think the king might be symbolic of? He's going to take account. What do you think that might be symbolic of? He has a servant. Who do you think the servant is symbolic of?
Us.
Mankind. Us. Exactly. He owed 10,000 talents. Now, I've got a note in my document here. According to Doug Batchelor, one talent is 6,000 days of wages for that man, for a normal man in that time.
It's a lot of talents.
It's a lot of talents. He owed 10,000 talents. 60 million days of labour. Converting that back to years, 230,670 years of labour. So, this debt, what does it represent? What's it symbolic of?
Unpayable.
Unpayable. What debt do we have that's unpayable?
The wages of sin is debt. We can't pay that one.
We can't pay that one. And if we did, what would it cost us?
Our life.
Our eternal life. So the debt that he's talking about here is equal to your eternal life.
Is the debt equal to our debt?
Say again, please, ma'am.
Is the debt that he owed sort of symbolic of the enormous debt that we
have? Yeah, that's exactly what it's saying. That's why 230,000 days of labour. Not possible.
So yeah. Even if he incarcerated him for the rest of his life, he still wouldn't get it back, so he might as well let him go.
Yeah. He's a very benevolent king, this king. What was the servant's request?
To give him
patience.
And I'll pay it.
And I'll pay it. Yes, Paul.
It just shows utter selfishness.
Well, given it is a parable, it didn't really happen. It
didn't matter, but... It's just an allegory.
No one in the world I should even think what he spent the money on.
I have to think he's running some sort of enterprise for the king to be a big investment in and help him in France.
It's the nature of sin. It's the nature of sin. I mean, how can we accrue so much sin? I mean, like, and compared to the rest of the universe, they look and just think, like, wow, what they're building up.
How could you possibly do all that?
Day after day.
Yeah, but maybe that's what the parable is about, that it's just that much selfishness in our lives that we can't even account for it.
We can't. Not possible. There's nothing we can do to repay the debt that we owe Christ. Well, that's the beauty of the gospel. Well, Colin, are you doing the value of a soul when you're doing that?
I have to pray.
So stick around, Shaquille.
What is the wages of sin?
Eternal non-existence.
Okay. So we commit how many sins? Is worth eternal non-existence?
One.
And how many have we committed? So how many eternal non-existence have we actually committed? This is this debt beyond
it's
reason.
Beyond
calculation.
Yeah, it's beyond fathom.
Yes.
Okay, so what did he ask for? Time? He asked for patience first, didn't he? and time to pay.
You would be way out of this.
Ah, that's what I'm looking for.
I'll trade my way out of this.
Another example
the old covenant.
Of the old covenant, works-based salvation. The compassion, the grace that this king displayed, isn't that symbolic of what Isaiah 44:22 says? I have covered your sins with a thick cloud. The forgiveness itself. This was a tough one to think about. The forgiveness itself, what does that symbolize? And I'm not saying I'm right, but it can possibly be Christ himself. Our substitute, our surety. So if we're thinking we're not forgiven, all we have to do is think, well, does Christ exist? Well, if Christ exists, my forgiveness must exist. Because it's part of his character.
Oh, wow.
So one of the things that I want you to notice in this story is that at what point in time did this unforgiving debtor ask for help?
It's too late.
After he'd been thrown in, he'd thrown somebody else in prison. But before his debt was forgiven, when did he ask for help?
Yeah, when he was called for account, but only when his accusation was made, even voluntarily coming and say, I was sorry, I can't pay this debt.
Yeah, but he didn't ask for forgiveness. That's the point I'm trying to raise.
Oh, okay, yeah, yeah, sure.
Yeah, sorry, I've asked the wrong question.
He didn't.
Notice that he didn't ask for forgiveness. Mm-hmm. So then, I want to explore that a little bit. Why does God require us to repent? Because if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most people leave off that last bit, and it's the most important bit. So, why does God ask us to confess? Doesn't he know already?
Yeah.
It's just like admitting it. Just to admit it. To admit it.
Yeah? Okay.
It's the sense of knowing that you need help. That you're willing to accept help.
You can only receive for something that you've asked for.
Yeah.
In that case, in this case.
Well, in this case, he received forgiveness and he didn't ask for it.
But from our Lord, if you repent, he's asking for forgiveness.
That's right.
I think Colin and I understand this a little better because we've done double entry accounting systems and we see two sides of every transaction. So I'll just go and I'll give an example. Let's suppose that at Passover, I offended my sister Bronnie. Really, really offended her badly. Bronnie, being the wonderful person that she is, she might argue with me, but I'll still says, well, I know Craig didn't mean it. And she forgives me. Takes 6 months before I come back to Tabernacles and I see Bronnie and I go, oh. And I go over to her and I say, 6 months ago, I did something. And I know it offended you. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? I said, don't worry about it. I forgave you 6 months ago. When did I receive her forgiveness? So, when was the burden lifted off me? When I confessed. What's the purpose of confession?
Good for the soul.
Good for the soul. Absolutely. Yes, Dad.
Because God says that he forgives for his own sake. I found a scripture the other day that really helped me. God forgives for his own sake. And that's a good reason for us to forgive.
Could God's character not forgive?
No.
Could he withhold forgiveness until we do something?
No.
If that was true, if he could withhold forgiveness until we did something, doesn't that say that we could then control God?
There's no doubt.
No. How ludicrous is that idea? And yet, as Colin and I don't know about you, Lester, but I heard that so much in my teenage years. drove me to almost suicide. So the question then is, if God has given me the gift of confession for my benefit, why do we talk about if you don't do it, you can't be saved? Again, it's the old covenant. It's the carnal heart. It's the natural man. You know, we're, I put myself in this category as well. In the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Ipswich, where I grew up, we were very good at telling everybody else what they needed to do. Incredibly good at it. So repentance and confession.
Can I just ask a question? Can you just, what you just done with the Christian who wants that it comes to God confessing and receiving the business that's already been done before? Can you just run through the scenario of a person who is not the disciple of the Christ, how that transaction works? Repeat the question.
Yes. Okay, repeating the question. Bronnie was wondering, if somebody's not in a relationship with Christ, how does that transaction work? Okay. Are you thinking about salvation when you ask that question?
No. I just want to know the differences between the two, the outcome and the two mindsets of person
who's wanting to be in okay. In my understanding, the ten lepers go to Christ, they're all cleansed, are they not?
Yes.
How many return?
One.
How many's redeemed?
Ten.
We're talking about the difference between redemption and restoration. Tissue's coming to me. God wants all to be saved, does he not? So he's provided the salvation for all. Now, again, big one. Yes, the forgiveness is there, but we haven't received it. Those that don't want a relationship with Christ don't receive it. If they don't receive that forgiveness, what happens to their mindset? Doesn't change, does it? So did they ever get restored to the position of Adam pre-fall? Whilst they are saved, only one was restored. The one that came back and has had a heart broken to say thank you.
The Samaritan. In the story with Bronwyn, they were offended her quite badly. You probably thought she might have forgiven you, but you're probably still dreading that next meeting because you've got this issue
that's still hanging around.
But once you've asked for forgiveness, it's just like a couple of ages ago, you know that the slate is clean. Mm-hmm. And you're quite comfortable meeting Bronwyn again, even though that happened, but you know that it's not a problem. But until you confess that, it's always a problem.
Yeah.
Yes, but it's not a problem for Bronnie, is it?
No.
It's only a problem for us. God knows, in our condition, that any unconfessed sin is an ammunition for who? And what's he going to do with that? He's going to destroy you with it. That's all he wants to do, is to destroy you with it. So this gift of repentance that God gives us, this gift of confession, when Satan comes to you, Shaquille, you said the other night that you were a bit low. Those thoughts aren't your thoughts. They're not God's thoughts either. There's only one person, one being that gives you those thoughts. And that's Satan. But when you've confessed that sin, you can smile and say, yes, I know, as Paul said, yeah, I know exactly what you're saying. And of the sinners, I am the greatest. I'm the greatest sinner in the world. But you know Jesus Christ, and you know what he's done for me, so you can just take a walk. You don't have to dwell on those thoughts. You don't have to let those thoughts control your mind as they used to control my mind, simply because the scripture is there. The problem that the world has at the moment is we haven't been telling them. The entire Christian world is still living in the Old Covenant. The entire Christian world has not yet heard the 1888 message. But take heart, Revelation 18, 1 to 4, it is going to happen. And that message is going to go around the world. Sort of getting off track a little bit here, but notice in the three angels' messages, the first message goes out with a loud voice. The third message goes out with a loud voice. The second angel's message is just said. There's no comment about how loud the voice is. But that message is repeated in Revelation 18 with a mighty voice. With great authority. Babylon. Our early pioneers used to love to point the finger at the nominal Adventists, as they called them, and say they were Babylon. What really is Babylon? Bring Babylon right back to its absolute root. What is Babylon?
Selfishness.
Babylon has to fall. And we think that the main thrust of that message is talking about the Pope or... It's not. It's the selfishness in here that has to fall. It's the process of restoration. When we are finally restored and Babylon is fallen, that message that goes out is going to be fantastic. But we have to look at that message as applying to us first before we can think of it in a corporate sense. Because individually, if it doesn't happen, it can never happen corporately, can it? So the reason that we're here trying to learn the truth is because we know that the blessing has been blocked. It's been blocked for a long time. God can use us as channels to get this message out. I can't think of anything more to say, so it's probably best I'll say nothing. But do you understand what I'm trying to get at with restoration? Yes, restoration is so important because it's when Christ Object's lesson, you might remember the page I can't, when Christ's character is perfectly replicated in the character of men, then he can come. That seems daunting at the moment because we realise that we don't represent Christ perfectly, do we? Well, what does Philippians 1:6 say? He that has begun a good work in Craig will complete it. He that has begun a good work in Paul will complete it. This restoration will be complete. It'll either be complete if you take the underground route, if we sleep before Christ comes. If we are alive when Christ comes, it'll be fully complete.
Christ has big lessons in 69.
Christ is waiting and longing, with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as their own. Christ Object Lessons, page 69, paragraph 1. And whilst that sounds daunting, it always will be unless you say with it that Christ is the one that's going to do that. All he asks me to do is in the level of my mind. Where does sin start? It's in here, isn't it? Any violation of God's character is just the physical evidence of what's happened in here before. So this is where the battleground is. The restoring of your mind, Romans 12:2. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. The only thing God asks of me is to choose. when you're faced with something that may not be, choose to say, as Paul said, I think it was Paul, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. Lord, I want to do the right thing, but I'm not capable. In this situation, you know how weak I am. It might be the one thing that Satan is just hammering you with. Might be alcoholism. It might be tobacco. It might be something. But you know your own weaknesses, and you know when Satan is tempting you with those weaknesses. You can just say, Lord, I can't do it. If you don't come and help me now, I can't do it. In part of my experience, Kathy had gone to Brisbane for whatever reason. I'd just dropped her off at the airport. And previous to this, I'd been looking for a 100mm nipple, PVC nipple, that's what it's called. And I went to this place that, and it had to be the mining grade, not the normal grade. And I went to this place in Townsville that supplied mining equipment. And they said, yes, they had one, but they were out of stock. But the young lady that I spoke to, the first thing she said to me, well, that's a long nipple. And immediately my brain went from where I was supposed to be to somewhere where I didn't want to be. And then I dropped Kathy off at the airport. And this young girl said she was able to try and get some for me. And when I was driving home, the phone rang, and it was this young girl. And she made some other innuendo when she was on the phone, telling me that she had the stock that I needed. I never went back there. I didn't even buy the bit that I needed. I just went to a different project. But I want to tell you the two thoughts that went through my mind then. The first thought was, I wonder what her nipple looks like. The second thought was, you've got a fortnight to find out. I was driving in a two lane, in the right hand lane. And I can remember saying, God, if you don't do something, I'm lost. I'm totally lost. I didn't even ask for relief from that. I just said, you've got to do something, because if you don't, I'm lost. And thankfully, I didn't think of her again. But can you understand the point? At the weakest point that Satan can get at you, all God says to you, when you recognize that, choose. I'll be your shield. Fear not, Abraham. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Just choose. There's nothing difficult about the plan of salvation. There's no work to be done. Yes, it is tough. Chenille confessed. A Christian walk is a tough walk. There's no denying that. But it's got nothing to do with restoration. That tough walk is perfection of our characters. I think I should remain quiet now for a little while. Colin has something for us. This is from Adventist Youth.
This is a letter, and this is why he wrote to her children.
This is a letter that Alan White wrote to her children.
One of the sons was ill, and she had no feeling that he was in a saving relationship. And this is what she wrote to her boys.
Okay, so the son was ill, for those that didn't hear Colin, and she had no conviction that he was in a saving relationship. So this is what she wrote to her children. Dear children, this dream has caused me to reflect and has cast a sadness upon my spirits that I cannot immediately throw off. You are, none of you, too young to die. Do you understand the plan of salvation? Our sins caused Jesus to die a shameful death, that through his sufferings and death we might receive pardon. Can we receive the forgiveness of sins before we feel that we are sinners? Read that again. Can we receive the forgiveness of sins before we feel that we are sinners, and before we realize the sinfulness of sin? I think not. When we repent before God of our sins sincerely, we shall feel that without the pardoning blood of Christ, we must perish. If we cast ourselves in our wretchedness wholly upon the mercy of Christ, and feel that unless he saves us, we perish, When we yield our own will, our own way, and plead for Jesus to control our will and actions, then we come into a position where we can receive and appreciate pardon and forgiveness of sins. Sometimes it takes us to get to the depths of the low to be able to recognise and do that. So, Shaquille, there's only one way up, one way, and it's up for you. For all of us.